Today we will take a very important topic of testosterone replacement therapy. In the past few years, testosterone replacement has become a buzzword across the world. And now it is estimated that around 35 to 40% of the elderly are on some form of testosterone replacement outside India. But for some reason, testosterone replacement has not picked up in India. So we will discuss a few points about testosterone replacement. I am Dr. Vijayant Govinda Gupta. I am a urologist from PGI Chandigarh, and currently I am running my own urology center called Govinda Medi Center in New Delhi. So New Delhi Andrology Clinic and Govinda Medi Center is India's premier men's health clinic. We are offering integrated holistic treatment for andrology. We have our in-house physician, a dermatologist, a psychiatrist. We have an endocrinologist, physio, and a gynecologist to manage the male infertility component. We have 3 operating rooms. We have 4 shockwave machines for our erectile dysfunction patients. And we are also the largest center performing penile implants in Asia. We are doing almost 600 penile implants a year, almost 50 penile implants every month. Recently, we have also started ultrasound and penile Dopplers in our center. We have in-house 2D echo. We have an in-house path lab. We are registered as a level 1 IUI clinic. And we have also started doing laparoscopy for infertile women. We also have a daycare chemo ward and a fully equipped laser dermatology center. So what is testosterone? So that is not something that we need to explain to the August gathering. So testosterone is a androgen group hormone, a steroid hormone, which stimulates the development of male secondary sexual characteristics. It has both anabolic and androgenic effects. So anabolic effects is basically linked to muscle mass, bone density, growth, and maturation. And androgenic effects are linked to the sex organs in terms of fertility, erections, libido, and the male sexual response. Now, there are several benefits of testosterone that the literature agrees on. So the first benefit of testosterone that is understudied and underreported is testosterone has a cardioprotective role. So patients with low testosterone have a higher incidence of major adverse cardiac events such as myocardial infarction, stroke, and it is now in multiple observational long-term observational studies, population-based observational studies, which say that low testosterone is linked to major cardiac events and adequate testosterone levels are linked with cardioprotective effects on lipid, on diabetic management, even on the heart and its working. Testosterone is very important for lean body mass. It helps in controlling weight, increasing the energy and gaining protein, gaining the muscle mass. So in men with testosterone deficiency, testosterone therapy will actually result in increased lean mass and reduce fat mass with no change in BMI. So it basically helps in maintaining the body fat percentage. It helps in stronger bones. So testosterone replacement helps in patients with osteopenia. So testosterone will actually help in maintaining stronger bones. Then the sexual benefits of testosterone in terms of better libido, erectile dysfunction, and testosterone can actually help people age gracefully. It helps in diabetes control. It is a mood elevator. It prevents depression. There is now long-term studies which say that low testosterone leads to Alzheimer's and problems with memory and cognition, anemia, energy fatigue, and in lipid profile. So if testosterone is so important, why are we not placing more stress on testosterone replacement? It is because till now we have not been able to define what is testosterone deficiency and what is low testosterone. Earlier word was andropause or androgen decline in the aging male, Adam. But these terms are not used any longer. Today the term that is used is testosterone deficiency syndrome, which basically means testosterone levels less than 300 along with clinical symptoms. So to label somebody as a testosterone deficient man, we need two things. One, the patient should have low testosterone, documented low testosterone, and documented symptoms of low testosterone. Just isolated low testosterone and no symptoms is not a criteria. But symptoms need not only be sexual. Erectile dysfunction, reduced libido is important, but the patients may also complain of muscle weakness, delayed puberty, depression, infertility, irritability, and weight gain. So if you look at the symptoms of testosterone deficiency, there are many. Reduced energy is one, reduced endurance is one. So many times patients will come to the clinic who will say that there is a lot of fatigue or lack of energy, diminished work performance, physical performance, loss of body hair, reduced beard growth, reduced lean muscle mass, obesity, depressive symptoms, cognitive problems, reduced motivation, poor concentration, irritability, reduced sex drive, and reduced erectile dysfunction. So all of these are actually signs of low testosterone. Now, very important to understand is that testosterone levels in a 50-year-old man is not equal to a 30-year-old man. So sometimes we have a range in our blood reports that we get from our labs, which give a range. And whenever you find somebody who's 350, and we have a tendency of saying testosterone is normal. But it is never like that. For a 25-year-old man, normal testosterone is actually 600 plus. And for a 50-year-old man, it is so at no level, it should testosterone levels be less than 400. But if the report is saying 250 or 300 for a young man, then it is actually low for that age group. So now the recent literature is going towards age-defined testosterone levels. So there are many charts available that can be utilized in centers that are treating. But for a cutoff value, 300 is what is accepted in literature. Now, how do you test for low testosterone if somebody comes to the clinic? So first, the clinician should use a total testosterone level of 300 as a reasonable cutoff in supporting a diagnosis. The diagnosis of low testosterone should be made only after two times early morning tests, and then only because testosterone goes through diurnal, weekly, and monthly variations. The clinical diagnosis is only made when low levels are combined with symptoms. And apart from testosterone levels, the clinician should also consider measuring testosterone in patients who have history of anemia, bone density loss, diabetes. In all diabetics, testosterone levels should be tested because testosterone replacement can help in show control. Then male infertility, again important, and somebody who is on chronic corticosteroid use. Adjunctive testing. Apart from testosterone, we should also consider measuring LH. We should also consider measuring prolactin because high prolactin can also lead to low testosterone. We should also consider measuring estradiol levels in patients with gynecomastia and hemoglobin at the start of therapy because testosterone replacement can sometimes cause polycythemia. Again, now one important clinical question is PSA. Should PSA be measured before starting testosterone levels? Yes, above 40, a baseline PSA before starting testosterone therapy is recommended. Now, you have a patient who has symptoms and you want to start his treatment. So the first thing that we need to understand is that in testosterone level, before we start treatment, we have to treat two things. One, his symptoms, and second, testosterone levels. So the target testosterone level is the middle range, that is 450 to 500. So whenever we start testosterone treatment, we need to measure testosterone every 3 months to check for the middle level. Very important is that oral testosterone is hepatotoxic, so we should avoid giving oral tablets. Instead of that, injectable testosterone or testosterone in gel form is a better form to use. So the goal of testosterone therapy is basically normalization of the total levels combined with improvement of signs. Range is 450 to 600. So we do not target testosterone above 1000 or no. Now, testosterone undequinate or Cernos capsule is an oral testosterone that is absorbed via the intestinal lymphatics. It helps in bypassing the liver effect. So it is less hepatotoxicity. But again, oral steroid use is definitely linked with some or other form of liver damage. So types of testosterone replacement therapy available in India right now is we have oral, we have pills. Sublingual is not available. transdermal, we have patches and gels, both are available. We have intramuscular injections available. Pellets are still not available. Now, the most common testosterone that physicians prescribe is sustenone. Now, problem with sustenone is a mixture of testosterone. It contains propionate, it contains cipionate, it contains deconate. So, problem is monitoring. So, because it has all three, it has a fast acting, middle acting, and a slow acting. So, you can never measure the response. So whenever you test, so the patient keeps going through troughs and highs and keeps getting irritable symptoms. So, whenever you are prescribing injectable testosterone, you should always go for a single solution. Either you go for weekly enanthate or you go for 3-monthly undeconate. That is a much better way because you can monitor the dose and the response of the patient. Sustenon, even though easy to administer, is not going to help you monitor the patient in the long term. So most patients will complain of good improvement in the first 15 days and then they will come back with a complete fall and say that we are feeling worse than before and then they will never want to take testosterone again. Now, what is the follow-up? So whenever the patient follows up after testosterone, first is symptom assessment. Has he noticed improvement in his pain score, fatigue, erections, hardness, in his libido, desire? Second is testosterone levels have to be measured every 3 months and dose need to be titrated. So for a 125 kg man, 1 gram of undeconate may be low and for a 65 kg man, it may be high. So we have to make sure that testosterone, so if for example at 3 months, the patient comes back and his testosterone level is 400, so we can increase the dose. And if the testosterone level is maybe 1000, so we can wait for it to come down further. Hemoglobin measurement is very important because testosterone causes polycythemia. So many times patient will come with very thick blood and that is a cause of venoembolic phenomena. So hematocrit measurement is very important. LFT if oral testosterone is being given. PSA every 6 months for the first 2 times and then if it is stable then no need. Blood pressure is very important because testosterone causes water retention and sometimes it can cause hypertension. So if patient of testosterone replacement is developing water retention, then maybe a low dose diuretic may be started. Body weight measurement, because testosterone patients may gain weight. Usually it is lean body mass, but if the patient is sedentary, then he may actually gain body fat percentage also. And blood sugar levels. So these are important follow-up parameters. Now, why are, as doctors, we are so afraid of prescribing testosterone to our patients when we know that testosterone is having multiple benefits? One is, it started with the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, the US, putting black box warning on testosterone. First was cardiovascular, that testosterone supplementation causes major adverse cardiac events. Now there is enough evidence, enough longitudinal studies, enough randomized controlled trials which say that testosterone supplementation does not cause major cardiac events. So major cardiac events are obviously going to happen in the age group in which we are giving testosterone. So there is no direct linkage of testosterone with cardiac events. Second, venothrombolic events. Again, it is because of the polycythemia. So if you are managing the polycythemia well, then venothrombolic events do not happen with testosterone. There is again multiple studies, large observational studies. Then prostate cancer. Many patients feel that by taking testosterone, they will develop prostate cancer. So now testosterone replacement is safe even in prostate cancer patients who have undergone radical prostatectomy. So prostate cancer has no linkage with testosterone supplementation. By giving testosterone replacement, we are not increasing the risk of the patient of elevation of PSA or getting prostate cancer. So I would like to end with this message that testosterone replacement is a safe and effective method of treating your general population of patients. It can help improve their cardiovascular effect, it can help improve their libido and their desire and their erectile functions, and it is extremely safe if given properly. So thank you so much.